Hello everyone, and welcome back to the Kohi Game Engine series. Today we are going to embark on the third and final leg of our input journey, at least for now. We're going to implement the Linux portion of this code today. Really quick though, I would like to take a quick second and thank the partners of the channel, Eearslya and Wensheng. The partner is the highest tier of supporter on the channel. And so I just wanted to say thank you to our partners as well as our other supporters that are listed here on the screen. So if you're interested in supporting the channel, there are a couple ways to do that now. First off, I have channel memberships available. You can access that by clicking the join button below this video. I'll also provide a link to a video that I have describing the memberships. And I also have a Patreon page, which is patreon.com/TravisVroman. Thank you all very much for your support. It is greatly appreciated. Last time we hooked up the Windows logic, which basically saw us hook this code up in the process message. And we're going to do the equivalent for Linux. Now, unfortunately, because of the way that Linux's key codes work, it's not going to be quite as straightforward. We're actually going to have to create a small translation layer between Linux's key codes and the key codes that we're using in the rest of the system. And this, I think, is probably going to wind up being true for Mac as well when we get to that. So what we're going to do is we're going to go ahead and tackle the keys first, right? So we have our key presses and our key releases here. So let's go ahead and get into it. So our key press event is an XCB press event, key press event rather. So basically we're going to just cold cast it to our known type and then go ahead and, as before, extract a pressed out of it. So if the response type is equal to XCB key press, which is basically saying if the message code is this, then we're gonna go ahead and say, okay, pressed is equal to true. The next thing that we need is we need to extract the key code, which is the detail of the keyboard event that we have casted here. So we'll go ahead and grab that code. And then the next thing that we're gonna have to do, we're gonna have to run this through a conversion from XKB key code to a key symbol. And that is going to basically give us a key symbol here that we can then translate into the code that we need. So the next thing that we're gonna have to do is, in order to get our key, we are going to have to call something called translate key code, which we haven't actually yet created. What this is gonna do is it's gonna take this key symbol here and translate it into one of our keys. Now we'll also note that we don't have this type, and that is because I forgot to go up here to the top and include input.h. I'm also gonna include event.h. All right, once we have our key code translated, then we can pass it at that point to our input subsystem for processing as normal. So there's a lot more translation that has to happen here, but that's just because it handles it a different way than we have set up for Windows. And this is okay, this stuff all runs relatively fast. It's just, this is sort of the price we pay for having that abstraction. Anyway, so we have this translate key code, which is not currently defined. So let's go ahead and set that up. So the first thing we're gonna wanna do is go to the top of the file, and we're going to want to forward declare that right before our platform startup. I'm gonna go ahead and take a copy of this and go to the bottom of the file. And just before our closing endif here, I'm going to put our function definition there. And what this is gonna do is it's going to take the X key code and it is going to run it through a switch. And unfortunately, there's not really too much of a cleaner way to do this. So we're basically going to take each one of the key codes that are defined for the X window system, which is basically defined by these XK underscore and then the name of the key. And we're going to return our known keyboard key type. So this means that for every key, we are going to have to make this translation, right? And so while this is a lot of code, thankfully, because it's a switch statement, it is actually pretty quick to evaluate. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to paste in all of our cases, because you guys probably don't want to type this out manually. There are some notes in here that I've put about key codes that we do not support on Linux because we don't have anything to actually translate them to. And that's fine, but for the most part, all the translations are here, at least the important ones that we really care about. So here is all the all the key codes. Now, one thing that you will notice is Linux actually provides different key codes for lowercase and uppercase. And that's not actually something that we want. So for each one of these, I'm also flattening those to the individual key type of that particular key. So if it's uppercase or lowercase, we just return our key A. So we're flattening all these things to our known key types, and that is basically the gist of our translate key code. Okay, and of course down here we have a default which returns zero if for some reason we did not match any key code. Okay, so that is the big complex piece in terms of keys and Linux. So that handles keys. The next thing that we're going to handle is mouse buttons. So our mouse button code is going to look very similar to our Windows code, except basically for this very first part. So we have our button press event, which is a cold cast from our event. And then we extract a press from that by saying, is the response type a XCB button press as opposed to a release? And then we have a mouse button, which is defaulted to max buttons, just like we did in Windows. And then we switch on the mouse event detail. So similar to what we did up here to the key code, to get the key code, we actually get the mouse button from the detail. So if the mouse button is index 1, it's left, index 2 is the middle or mouse wheel if we click on that. And then the mouse button index 3 is the right button. So once we have that, then we just do a quick check, sanity check, to make sure that our mouse button is not still the default that we defined up here, and go ahead and pass it through to our input process button function. Okay. The next thing is going to be mouse movement. So the XCB motion notify handles that for us, and that one is actually dirt simple. So again, we do a cold cast of the event, this time to a XCB motion notify event. And here we say input process mouse move, and we pass the move event, event X, and move event, event Y. And that's all there is to mouse movement. It's nice and simple. It's actually simpler than the Windows version. And that should be just about it. The only thing I'm choosing not to display, not to handle right now, is the mouse wheel. I figure I can add that at a different point, but for now the mouse wheel will not work on Linux. We'll add that in a future video. Okay, so let's go ahead and build this real quick. Whoops, we got some errors here. What did I do? Looks like our kmemory.c does not like our string duplicate. That would be right here, 109. Right, it thinks it's an integer because it can't find it. That is probably because string duplicate is something that is only available on Windows, I believe, if I recall correctly. So actually that is something that we'll need to probably handle in a video coming soon. We'll need to set up our basic string library. So I think the way that I'm going to handle this is actually I'm going to go ahead and implement this myself and not use this string duplicate here and just implement what it actually does under the hood, just so we can get around this problem on this particular platform, and then we'll implement the rest later. So real quickly, under core, I'm going to create a new file. I'm going to call it kstring.h. And we'll start that off with a pragma once and defines.h, as we have done so many times in the past. And I'm going to create a function called string duplicate, and it's going to be exported. And I'm going to create another new file, and I'm going to call that kstring.c. And in that, I am going to include kstring, kmemory, because we're going to need that. And then we are also going to need string.h. And all string duplicate is going to do is, this is basically what the string dupe does under the hood, is we're going to get the length of the string to determine how much memory we need to reserve. We are going to allocate a new character array, that length plus 1, to account for the null terminator. We are going to copy from the string into our copy here. Of course, our length plus 1 to accommodate for the null terminator, and then we're going to return the copy. This is basically everything that string dupe does under the hood. So go ahead and save this and go back to kmemory.c. And we'll go to the top here. And see, I knew this was going to bite me. That's why I put a to-do here. I knew that was going to come back and haunt me. So we will go ahead and say core k string. Let's move that up one actually. And then come back down here and say string duplicate. Let's go ahead and build that. Let's see, what are we getting a warning for? Up string length, because I copied this from my string library and I don't have string length. Dang it. Okay, so I might as well go ahead and put that one in here since I already kind of let that cat out of the bag. I'll go ahead and add this one in here for string length and add in string length, which for now simply just returns the result of string length here, the actual C library. Eventually we're going to be making our own version of that, but this is sort of our way of abstracting that. And that is needed here. So let's go ahead and build and run. And we can see here that our output looks correct. We can go ahead and press some keys here. We can see our explicit key press works, our explicit key release works. All of our other keys seem to be working just fine. And if I go ahead and press escape, event code, application quit received, shutting down, and there we are. So we're all hooked up and ready to go. That is pretty much it for the input system. I really didn't want to go down this road of creating the string library, but that is something we're not going to be able to avoid for too much longer. In fact, we're going to need some of that stuff for Vulkan. So more than likely, we're going to be coming back and at least implementing some of these string methods so that we're not using, you know, some of these sort of oddball string duplication methods that are only supported on one particular platform or for one compiler. Or version of a compiler. So anyway, thank you guys so much for watching. I hope you enjoyed this and I hope you learned. If you liked the video, go ahead and toss it a like, thumbs up. If you haven't already, consider subscribing and click the little notification bell there to get notified as to when new videos in this or other series of mine drops. And I will see you guys next time.